Greetings. I wanted to talk about a concept that has been percolating in my heart for a while. I leave it up to you and your leading inside to see if what I say has merit. The Left Behind series has popularized certain concepts about the rapture. Please don't get me wrong. The closer we get to that day, the more I become convinced of the rapture. But the Left Behind series has depicted and popularized several concepts I'd like you to think about. The first idea is that our bodies, our carnal, unrenewed, secular bodies, get raptured. You've probably already figured this out long ago. But let's think about this for a moment. When you die, what part of you goes to heaven? The correct answer is your spirit, right? And where does your body go? The physical atoms of your body go into the ground. Is there any scripture which specifically addresses this? Genesis 23:4, I am a stranger and a sojourner with you. Give me a possession of a burying place with you that I may bury my dead out of my sight. Not a specific command, but an example that Abraham buried his dead wife Sarah. 1 Kings 31:29, and the prophet took up the carcass of the man of God, and laid it upon the ass and brought it back, and the old prophet came to the city to mourn and to bury him. Verse 30, and he laid his carcass in his own grave, and they mourned over him, saying, Alas, my brother. And it came to pass after he had buried him that he spoke to his sons, saying, When I am dead, then bury me in the sepulchre wherein the man of God is buried. Lay my bones beside his bones. The dead body of the prophet was respected, but still buried in a sepulchre. Matthew 8:22, But Jesus said unto him, Follow me, and let the dead bury their dead. Here, Jesus speaks of the spiritually dead burying the dead bodies of those who had physically died. And where some cultures cremate or burn bodies on a pyre, Judaism and Christianity typically bury their dead or entomb them. The point here for you to recognize is that your physical body serves no purpose when you die. But what about this passage? 1 Corinthians 15, 51-53. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Let's take a look at it, shall we? Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. First of all, it says this is a mystery. To me, this is one of the many things Jesus could not tell his believers before the Comforter came to them. John 16:12, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. The rapture is to come, something the Holy Spirit would reveal. This is one of the truths that men could not understand. To a man without the Spirit of God, the rapture is a mystery. And what exactly is so mysterious about the rapture? Well, to a person with the Comforter, led by the Comforter, the answer should be nothing. But let's take a look about how the rapture is described. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. There are three key concepts presented in this verse. The timing, the dead and what happens to them, and us that are not yet dead, the alive. The timing. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound. This will be a fast event. A moment, as fast as a blink. Bam! And in that instant of time, something happens to the dead and the living. At the rapture, the dead, those already in the grave, whose bodies may have even decayed back to dust, they, the dead, will put on an imperishable body, a new body that cannot perish, cannot decay. And those still alive will also be changed. We too, the living, will put on our imperishable body, a new body that cannot perish, cannot decay. And that is the concept I want you to understand. Our current, decaying, perishable, physical body serves no purpose in heaven. If you are alive, at the instant of the rapture, you will put on your new eternal body. Presumably, that also means you take off your old corruptible body. When you are raptured, you will have no need for this physically limited, corruptible, perishable flesh. So does it make sense in your mental depiction of the rapture to include the detail that your body floats up into the sky out of sight? Somewhat more disturbing may be the imagery some fantasize that we float up naked. I really think, while clever and an attempt to be shocking and poignant, such imageries miss the depth of the point. And here is the first point of this video. I think we should consider the possibility that the rapture will leave millions of dead bodies lying around. Why? Because our spirits, that which is really us, our spirits, will be called up to be with the Lord in heaven, and our bodies, no longer of use to us, will be left behind. And if millions of us Christians leave, that will leave millions of suddenly dead bodies all across America and around the world. I say millions because I am not convinced the 1.6 billion people who categorize themselves as Christian will necessarily go to heaven or participate in the rapture. Matthew 7:14, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leads unto life, and few there be that find it. Few. And a highway will be there. It will be called the way of holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go about on it. Wicked fools will not walk in the way of life. It will not matter what they call themselves, Christian or not. Wicked fools will mock people walking in the way of life as nothing more than bitter people clinging to their God and their guns. Matthew 25:1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. Then shall this example make sense. When? Then. Right after the things that came before the then. Matthew 24:37. But as the days of Noah were, so also shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Verse 42, watch therefore, for you know not at what hour your Lord does come. 46, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he comes, shall find so doing. 48, but, and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delays his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looks not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then, bam! Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. They were watching for their Lord, for the bridegroom. And here is another concept you must take to heart. All 10 were watching, but only 5 were prepared. You need to discern your level of commitment and preparation for His coming. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. There's some more to come in part 2.